It was the dawn of the third age of mankind, 10 years after the Earth-Minbari War. The Babylon Project was a dream given form. Its goal, to prevent another war by creating a place where humans and aliens could work out their differences peacefully. It's a port of call, home away from home for diplomats, hustlers, entrepreneurs, and wanderers. Humans and aliens wrapped in 2,500,000 tons of spinning metal, all alone in the night.
This is the start of Babylon 5, a sprawling five-season space epic that stitches together stories about conflict, philosophy, religion, diplomacy, corruption, and unity. Several months ago, HBO Max added this series to their collection, almost 30 years since the pilot episode first aired, now remastered for HD and on a streaming service for the first time. But given its age, is this series any good? I watched this series with my parents way back when it first aired, but now I got to watch this great show with my wife, who had never seen it. So hopefully I have a few different perspectives. Does it still hold up? Well, it does show its age at spots. Sometimes the episodes aren't quite as riveting as more modern stories like Game of Thrones, The Expanse, or Westworld. But without Babylon 5, these shows wouldn't exist. Let's start with some history. We can't really talk about Babylon 5 without talking about its creator. Joseph or J. Michael Straczynski, disenfranchised with TV science fiction shows that lacked any sort of long-term planning, started writing his own notes and backstory for Babylon 5. JMS had a rather seasoned writing career, even at the time, writing radio plays, news articles for the LA Times, the San Diego Reader, and other local newspapers, several books, including an educational book about screenwriting. He also wrote several scripts for animated shows like He-Man and The Real Ghostbusters, sci-fi shows like The Twilight Zone, and even more mundane shows like Murder, She Wrote and Walker, Texas Ranger. But throughout the history of television series, none of them really told a full-length episode-to-episode continuous storyline. Sure, there were series that toyed with the idea of a thinly threaded plot. JMS even called his idea an adult approach to sci-fi, and an attempt to do for television sci-fi what Hill Street Blues did for cop shows. But for most of these series, each episode was designed to reset the scenario back to a default state. There was no permanent change. Even Star Trek The Next Generation, which was already several seasons in at the time, didn't dare to truly change the status quo of their universe. Straczynski read many sci-fi and fantasy sagas that spanned several books for a single story. And this was how JMS pitched this idea. A novel for television with each episode representing a chapter. He first attempted to sell this idea to Paramount in 1989, complete with artwork, concepts, a pilot script, plot synopsis, etc. Paramount declined, but more on that bit later. JMS eventually got his show. The pilot first aired in February of 1993, and the series came in full swing with the first episode airing on January 26, 1994. And this show was a big freaking deal. Admittedly, teenager me and family didn't quite get into the series until season 2, content with watching episodes of Star Trek The Next Generation. We saw an episode from season 1 here and there while we were channel surfing, but it didn't quite click yet. But eventually there was a lot of buzz at the time that was hard to avoid, even pre-internet. It's not like today, where social media instantly lights up a new show and creates a global buzz, but word of mouth still slowly built a following. A friend of mine was asking the same thing that thousands of other people were asking their friends. What's up with this show that has this plot that continues from episode to episode? What if you miss an episode? Is it going to be a good idea, especially if a newcomer jumps into the middle of it? It was a legitimate fear. I'm certain it weighed on the minds of many, many TV executives who rejected this idea, afraid of bucking the tried and true formula because anybody can just jump into an episode and enjoy a bite-sized, hour-long show. It wasn't an age where you can easily rewind 5 minutes of an episode, much less watch earlier episodes. Everything had to be shown at a certain time, and if you missed an episode, who knows when a set of reruns came along. But we all know why it works, here and now in the year 2021. We all take for granted what Straczynski dared to pursue as a television series. We are enveloped in countless series that follow a similar path, spoiled for choice for any streaming service, offering 100 of these series. Especially in an age where TV series are now telling better stories than movies. Besides just the storytelling, this show pioneered in many other ways. It was one of the first series to use early generation CGI, using Amiga's Video Toaster and Lightwave 3D. The animation and effects, while they clearly look like computer animation, still holds up today. This is especially true in an age when the first 3D games we got our hands on, even 5 years later, looked like this. Believe it or not, this decision was partially made to reduce the budget of each episode, producing episodes at a third of the budget of Star Trek The Next Generation, who were still using models and miniatures for most of their space shots. The series was first shot in 16:9 aspect ratio with 5.1 surround sound, despite having to downscale the format back to 4:3 format for cable TV. Straczynski had the foresight to realize that higher definition television was going to come to people's houses eventually. While the 16:9 aspect ratio couldn't be used for various other reasons, the other high-def choices made it that much easier for HBO to produce the remastered streaming version. Babylon 5 earned several awards for costumes, makeup, and special effects. The costumes and makeup really gave each alien race their own unique look, and I think they did a better job here than Star Trek did at times, with their sometimes lazy application of a prosthetic here and some coloration there to a mostly humanoid face. The aliens of Babylon 5 all had their motivations, quirks, religions, and personality. JMS used the internet all the way back in freaking 1991 to talk to fans on Usenet and promote the series. I mean, there's a dedicated Wikipedia page on it and everything. He continued to talk to fans throughout the production of the series, talking about how the plot developed, technical details around the production of the show, even debunking certain fan theories and answering questions without giving away the future plot. Here was an age where the internet was just a bunch of text menus and dial-up modem noises, an invention that people barely realized existed, and Straczynski was using it like people use forums like Twitter and Reddit today.
Well, as my great-grandfather used to say, cool.
Stuart Copeland, yes, that's Stuart Copeland, drummer for The Police, and a name that seems to crop up all over the place in movie and TV soundtracks, ended up composing music for the pilot. Though, because of touring commitments for The Police, JMS had to look for another musician. So he asked around on Genie, an old internet message board, and a few people recommended Tangerine Dream member Christopher Frank, who he hired as a soundtrack musician for the rest of the series. And I'm sure this is the point where I've lost all of my millennial and Zoomer audience, but these are all well-known bands back in the day. But I should get back to that elephant in the room, Star Trek. Look, when somebody asked me if my favorite captain is Kirk or Picard, my response would be, Captain Benjamin Sisko.
You hit me. Picard never hit me.
I'm not Picard.
Deep Space Nine Star Trek is best Star Trek, but there's a reason why Deep Space Nine ended up being so memorable, and it had to do with its competition. Paramount had the basic plans for Babylon 5, and while I can't say the writers and showrunners stole the whole concept, they were still borrowing ideas and watching this grand experiment unfold as it was happening. Deep Space Nine's first episode aired just 1 month before the Babylon 5 pilot. Both these series developed in parallel and aired in parallel. Deep Space Nine was initially very episodic and disconnected from any overarching plot, but plans started to set in motion at around season 3 and kicked off into a full-scale story arc by season 5. Undoubtedly, Deep Space Nine showrunners were paying attention to Babylon 5's model and seeing if it was successful before they dipped their toes in the same type of long-term planning that served as the tenet of Babylon 5's storytelling. Both series ultimately benefited from the model, but Babylon 5 was a real trailblazer here. Soon it would become the norm for all future sci-fi shows, and eventually all TV series. But how does Babylon 5's story hold up almost 30 years later? I mean, it still has its cringy 90s moments, still borrowing from sitcom writing, when shows of the sort thought they still had to inject cheap laughs instead of embracing the drama of today's more serious television series. The first season was also kind of rough, but TNG had a similar problem with its first season. I ended up using an episode watch list to skip certain episodes, but halfway through the second season, every episode becomes required viewing. Honestly, I think it's really only an issue for season one. I didn't bother with reordering the episodes like some lists recommend. But it's still better to have these occasionally bad episodes than the modern pattern of producing only 13 or 10 or even 6 episodes per season. I feel like modern series producers are daring each other to strip out more and more episodes out of their seasons to justify spending less and less from their budgets. They may have better pacing for their main stories, but it robs a lot of character development you get out of these side stories. The overall story arc is solid, telling the story of an intergalactic war of light and dark, with political intrigue, infighting between the various alien races, even some Lovecraftian influences in place. Religion is a major theme throughout this series, as each of the major races have their legends of ancient wars and old gods living among them. There are personal stories of addiction and the unfortunate classism of Babylon 5, with down below housing the unlucky and downtrodden. There are certain sexually creepy moments that might have worked in the 90s, but don't really fly today. You don't really see him often, but Garibaldi seems to get the brunt of these bad lines, despite being a deep and complex character.
Afterward, if you like, you can stop by my quarters and I can show you my favorite thing in the whole universe. Have you ever tried one of these?
What is it?
I'm not sure. According to the translator, it's either an aphrodisiac or a floor wax. Can't decide if it's worth the risk or not.
Mr. Garibaldi.
Please. Michael. Did I mention I really enjoy your broadcasts?
Casual thoughts are very easy to block, but strong emotions have a way of slipping through sometimes, whether you want them to or not.
Blue 14.
Do you know what it's like when telepaths make love, Commander? You drop every defense, and it's all mirrors. Reflecting each other's feelings.
It seems like every time I get into the tube, Mr. Garibaldi's there. It's like he knows.
Talia, Mr. Garibaldi is many things, but he's not omniscient.
This is more of a product of the era itself and that sitcom-style writing. On the flip side, there are a lot of strong female characters on this show. Everybody's favorite is obviously Delenn, who's equal parts divine wisdom and kick-ass one-liners.
Negative. We have authority here. Do not force us to engage your ship.
Why not? Only one human captain has ever survived battle with the Minbari fleet. He is behind me. You are in front of me. If you value your lives, be somewhere else.
Commander Ivanova keeps the station in line.
Confirm, Survey 1. Upon arrival, you will report for debriefing. And just one more thing. On your trip back, I'd like you to take the time to learn the Babylon 5 mantra. Ivanova is always right. I will listen to Ivanova. I will not ignore Ivanova's recommendations. Ivanova is God. And, if this ever happens again, Ivanova will personally rip your lungs out. Babylon Control out.
Lita Alexander, while she seems kind of meek at first, grows into her own later on.
What do you know about hell? Would you like me to show it to you? Mine and his.
Lockley in season 5.
I'm pretty much up to speed on all the reports.
With all due respect, there's a lot that doesn't fit into a report.
Then the report is incomplete.
Even some of the minor characters like Natoth and Tessa are well developed in parts that could have been easily given to male actors. Though I do think the show's age gave way to a few now hilarious predictions of the future, such as newspapers, which were custom printed according to the person's preferences, but still mostly the same as newspapers of old, complete with the Universe Today gag that only Gen Xers and boomers are really going to understand nowadays. Really, paper documents in general.
Never ceases to amaze me. Every time someone says we're becoming a paperless society, I get 10 more forms to fill out.
I suppose the TNG datapad props were hard to simulate in the early 90s, but perhaps they could have had some space-age paper for confidential materials. Channel surfing, and an age where people still watch live television. The ISN news station is a fairly important part of the series, and everybody's watching the news on TV and bars. I suppose people still are doing that in airports and bars, but I really wouldn't expect that to last much longer. And most everybody watches some form of pre-recorded TV in the 21st century, so flipping through channels in the 23rd century just seems dated.
Stand down. Amazing. All those channels and nothing worth watching.
People still care about opera?
Milagrosa Vittima.
Ti vai magri soledad, ti mai dara vizima.
Aia vita, l'estero, l'estero vigri.
And that sound, that hideous sound, it's non-opera.
Sure, stage plays have had a resurgence over the last decade or so, but I can't imagine people in the 23rd century listening to opera. Or a regression of comedy where Penn and Teller end up being universally loved physical comedians. Seriously, who watches Three Stooges or gets cracked up over fart jokes nowadays?
And the less said about the comedy team of Rebo and Zooty, the better.
However, you don't like Rebo and Zooty? They're hysterical.
Are they? I'm sorry. I apparently mistook you for a human with some taste and sensibility. After their last broadcast, everywhere I went on the station, someone was going, Zooty, zoot, zoot, at me.
It was a great routine.
I didn't get it.
I'm with Londo. I don't get how Zooty, zoot, zoot is any sort of worthwhile punchline. Though they do get a lot of the technical sci-fi detail right, like spinning gravity.
Listen, I am prepared to give you one, Commander, as soon as the room stops spinning.
This station creates gravity by rotation. It never stops spinning.
And detailed explanations about alien diseases. It's the kind of science fiction detail we've grown to expect in the 90s, when the TNG crew were hiring teams of technical advisors, creating their own languages, and writing entire technical manuals for fictional universes. Experts in their respective fields or even hobbyists appreciate that attention to detail. It makes the universe feel more real, and not something you have to spackle with a heavy suspension of disbelief. Not like what it eventually devolved into just a few years later. Technobabble.
You'll have to isolate the subassembly tolerances from the emitter algorithms.
Whoa, hold on a minute.
By synchronizing the transporter's annular confinement beam to the warp core frequency.
Work has been proceeding on the crudely conceived idea of an instrument that would not only provide inverse reactive current for use in unilateral phase detractors.
You're saying the assembly's independent of the emitters?
Exactly.
But would also be capable of automatically synchronizing cardinal gram meters.
The secondary gyrodyne relays in the propulsion field intermatrix have depolarized.
I'm gonna try a skeletal lock.
A what?
Now basically, the only new principle involved is that instead of power being generated by the relative motion of conductors and fluxes...
That's impossible.
Not if you generate a stable flux between the positron conductors.
I think I can get a clean lock on the minerals in their bone tissue.
It's produced by the modal interaction of magnetoreluctance and capacitive diractance.
In English,
I'm just reading what it says here.
Then all you'll have to do is renormalize the tertiary wave functions.
It's a symbol for fractal neuronic cloning.
I just came up with it, but I think it might work.
The original machine had a base plate of prefamulated amulite surmounted by a malleable logarithmic casing, in such a way that the two spurving bearings were in a direct line with a panometric fam.
Do you think it's because the subspace conduits have locked with the transponder calibrations and caused a major tachyon surge that has overloaded the time matrix?
His theory was that Data's entire code, even his memories, could be reconstituted from a single positronic neuron.
The main winding was of the normal lotus-o-deltoid type placed in panendermic semi-boloid slots of the stator.
No, sir, I've just been jabbing it too hard.
Once the convergence effect has been reversed, we'll dial those different points of origin and create wormholes that will follow the interuniversal pathways already created by their initial trips here.
I got it.
Every seventh conductor being connected by a non-reversible tremie pipe to the differential girdle spring on the up end of the gram meters.
We need to discuss how to build a suit of time-traveling power armor so that it could pull the Starship Discovery through a spatial vortex and into the future.
I'll create a GUI interface using Visual Basic. See if I can track an IP address.
I cracked him. Downloaded firmware and nmapped the script so I could view the ciphertext with a verbose switch.
Moreover, whenever fluorescent score motion is required, it may also be employed in conjunction with a drawn reciprocation dingle arm to reduce sinusoidal deplaneration.
The kid's Gen 9 SD is Wi-Fi enabled. Fanboy here tracked the IP address of the dynamic host configuration protocol assigned to the ARM9 processor and was then able to ping the server's geolocation vector.
What if we use the deflector dish to open a rift to another dimension, then use the ship's RAM scoops to collect the tachyon particles?
Boy, what's wrong, Rick? Is it the quantum carburetor or something?
Quantum carburetor? Jesus, Morty, you can't just add a sci-fi word to a car word and hope it means something.
The retroencabulator has now reached a high level of development, and it's being successfully used in the operation of Milford Trunnions. It's available soon wherever Rockwell Automation products are sold.
I like science.
It's also nice to see how citizens and crew members of Babylon 5 spend their time off. Bars and casinos are very popular hotspots.
Man, I need a drink. Water, straight up.
There's also the 5-star Fresh Air restaurant, where you can take up batting practice in the baseball field, or engage in more personal hobbies like cooking, or building your own motorcycle, or watching Looney Tunes. Hey, you do you, Mr. Garibaldi. Though, far, far too many plot points rely on some video call interrupting an embarrassing moment, or walking into a doorless room to interrupt a critical diplomatic conversation.
Dismissed.
He's lying. I can tell.
You know, if you ask me, I think someone in Earthdome has gone completely mental.
That's an interesting opinion.
Captain, thank you. We appreciate your cooperation. Thank you.
He knows all the right things to say.
So we will fix this by removing ourselves from your immorality.
Captain.
Ambassador.
Hey, private meeting going on over here. Take a hike.
Do these people believe in privacy? Why doesn't the computer wait for you to respond before the video call starts? Maybe don't have the captain's office attached to an open hallway? At least Enterprise D and Deep Space Nine had the right idea.
Computer. Security override request.
Identify.
Picard, Jean-Luc, Captain, USS Enterprise. Request control access. Starfleet ship, USS Lantry, ISO Talaka commanding.
Enter access code.
Omicron, Omicron, Alpha, Yellow, Daystar, 27. Enable.
Work out in the open on the bridge, but if the captain needs to have an argument or another important private conversation, that's what the ready room is for. That station layout flaw did bother me a bit, but overall the show did really good at presentation. There's these set pieces that were presented in critical places in the plot that were really memorable for me back then. So much so that rewatching the series 30 years later, I realized they were smaller than what I remember. I think it's a testament to both its great storytelling and how this motley crew of set designers were able to pull off fantastic scenes on a fairly modest budget. Overall, I think I'm nitpicking most of the bad elements, and the positives of the show far outweigh the negatives. Okay, I'm getting into some season-by-season details. Skip ahead near the end if you want to avoid any spoilers. First, I really appreciate the different intros each season had. Each intro had a different character detailing what to expect from the season, and reflecting on events of the past. Commander Sinclair giving a new audience how life on the station works.
Creating a place where humans and aliens could work out their differences peacefully. It's a port of call, home away from home for diplomats, hustlers, entrepreneurs, and wanderers.
Captain Sheridan hinting at the impending danger to come.
It was the dawn of the third age of mankind. The year the Great War came upon us all.
Commander Ivanova really hammering home how bleak the situation is in Season 3 with that blunt delivery.
The Babylon Project was our last best hope for peace. It failed.
And every major character in the season 4 intro telling the audience how dramatic that season was going to be.
It was the year of fire.
The year of destruction.
The year we took back what was ours.
It was the year of rebirth.
The year of great sadness.
The year of pain.
And a year of joy.
It was a new age.
It was the end of history.
It was a year everything changed.
And, well, Season 5's lackluster intro, but we'll get into that later. A detail like this was unprecedented in television, where everybody just designs a single intro and shows it for 3, 5, 10 years. TV execs were wanting to cultivate a feeling of familiarity and consistency within their series, after all. You remember this series from years ago? Well, it's still the same great thing it was, and you're going to be getting the same kind of episodes you remember. Even today, in an age where continuous storylines are the norm, it's still fairly rare to see a studio spend money to recreate new seasonal intros. Farscape borrowed the idea several years later, but you really didn't see it catch on until people were paying attention to the subtle changes in Game of Thrones intros. Now you see them more often with shows like Westworld seasonal intros, and WandaVision experimenting with changing details each episode. As I said before, the first season was a little rough, but I can forgive a sci-fi show for stumbling around a bit before the writers can figure out what works and what doesn't. Star Trek The Next Generation Season 1 was rough. Farscape had a rough start and needed several episodes to find its flow. Even the first several episodes of The Expanse were kind of rough, especially for someone who read the first book. But getting back to Babylon 5, I did find the first episode a decent introduction to the series. And the pilot, while it was a bit disconnected from what we ended up with in the first season, is worth watching for the backstory, a bit of history on how the show evolved, and to give you a general idea of what you're getting into. That pilot actually does get referenced in later episodes too. However, despite the need to acclimate the audience to station life in general, we do get a lot of hints of future developments in Season 1, including the Minbari's interest in Sinclair, Mr. Morden's initial contacts with Londo, the sudden appearance of Babylon 4, and ending with the assassination of President Santiago. My wife's initial impression of the series was, wow, this show is actually pretty dark and isn't afraid of violence. And compared to the squeaky clean image of Star Trek that Next Generation was pushing, it was. Sci-fi wasn't showing this kind of tone yet, and I think that was part of the appeal. By the end of Season 1, Sinclair marries his longtime girlfriend, and it's a shame that by the end of Season 2, we have a potentially interesting character completely written off of the show, and Sinclair suddenly moved to Minbar. But there is a very good reason for that. Michael O'Hare, the actor who played Commander Sinclair, was starting to suffer from paranoid delusional behavior during the filming of Season 1, and it only got worse as the season continued on. Halfway through the season, JMS brought him in to talk. What JMS heard made him start to understand what was going on, and he convinced Michael that he needed help. JMS offered to shut down the show for a bit while Michael got the help he needed, but Michael didn't want to be responsible for pulling the plug on the show and jeopardizing everybody's jobs. So Michael convinced JMS to let him power through the rest of the season. And with Straczynski's help, he did.
And I said, if you really want a chance, I'll give you that chance. But we're going to assign someone to work with you and keep an eye on you. The moment the needle goes into the red, we're pulling the plug. I understand that. He said, I understand. I will work with you. We'll make this happen. And he held on by his fingernails for that season. I could see the strain it was taking on him, the toll it was taking, but he held on. And I was at any moment prepared to pull the trigger on this thing. We finished the season up, and I pulled him into the office. I said, you and I both know this is getting worse. You both know you're not going to make it to another season if things as they are. I'm going to move on from you as the commander of the station. Don't worry about it. Whatever your rent needs are for the while, I'll take care of it. Food, I got it covered. We will get you treatment. We will get you better. And I spent the next year or so working with him and to a degree with his family to get him the care that he needed while we brought on Sheridan to say that role and got him the proper meds. It was a long process of getting it worked out. In the next year, I said, can you come back to do a two-part? We kept the secret because they wanted to kill his career. And got him to a point where he could now come back and do a two-parter to close off that arc and introduce the notion of him being Valen. And we finished the episode, and as we're sitting in the office, I said, we're going to keep working with you and make this better, and I'll keep the secret to my grave. He says, you don't have to. He says, look, keep it to my grave, because if anything ever happens to me, I want people to know that this is a problem, and here's why I left. Because people need to know that there's a problem in their family. If this can happen to an actor, a star of a show, a commander of a station, it can happen to anyone, and it's not a scandalous thing. It can be dealt with. So if anything ever happens to me, I want you to be free to talk about this.
We only know of this information because Straczynski kept his promise. On September 28th, 2012, Michael O'Hare died in a coma due to complications from a heart attack. 8 months later, and 20 years after Babylon 5 first aired, Straczynski recited this story for the first time to fans at a Phoenix Comic Con. JMS recalled that while the Babylon 5 crew lost a lot of good cast members over the years, Michael O'Hare's death was the most tragic. Season 2 introduces us to a new leader to helm Babylon 5, Captain John Sheridan. The writing gets a lot better in Season 2 as well. There's still some standalone and or forgettable episodes here and there, but it really hits its stride in the season. The Shadow War starts to coalesce. Night Watch and the other 1984-esque ministries gain a foothold. And by the time we reach the end of the season, Narn has been conquered by the Centauri, ending any shred of diplomacy that Babylon 5 symbolized. Season 3 gives us a ramp-up of the Shadow War, Earth's descent into a fully authoritarian regime, and Centauri's ongoing corruption into chaos. Like I mentioned before, even the intro reveals how grim the future will be. But underneath it all, we see resistances form, new alliances being forged, and relationships grow. All leading up to a season cliffhanger to end all cliffhangers.
Jump. Jump. Now.
But it's season 4 that ends up being the standout for the entire series. This is where the slow burn of the show turns into a full-on action-packed space opera. This is where most of our questions get answered. The pacing of season 4 was somewhat accidental, though. JMS always intended for Babylon 5 to be a 5-season affair. See, Babylon 5 was airing on the Primetime Entertainment Network, or P10 for short. It was a broadcast network owned by a joint venture between Warner Brothers and Chris Kraft Industries. They were trying to challenge the big three, NBC, CBS, and ABC. As far as national coverage, they had a good footprint, but Babylon 5 was their biggest flagship show, with bland and unremarkable TV series like Time Tracks and Kung Fu The Legend Continues playing second fiddle. Right around when Season 4 was in its planning stages, the two partners formed their own networks, which signaled the demise of P10. Warner Brothers partnered with Tribune Company to form the WB, and Chris Kraft Industries partnered with Paramount Television to form UPN. Both of these companies later merged to form the CW in 2006. With P10 struggling to stay afloat, JMS knew that Babylon 5 just had a season left to wrap up things. So he focused on tying up the three big plot lines: the Shadow War, the overthrow of the Centauri Emperor, and the overthrow of President Clark. While the season was compressed, JMS pulled the pacing off well, and we get some of the best, most memorable episodes of the season. JMS even filmed Sleeping in Light, the series finale, in preparation for the series getting canceled on season 4. It was only when TNT picked up Babylon 5 at the 11th hour did Straczynski film the second finale, The Deconstruction of Falling Stars. JMS didn't want to show the real series finale prematurely, so he kept Sleeping in Light in his back pocket. In that season 4 finale, we get a wild history of the Babylon 5 universe from progressively further points in the future. From just a year ahead, to 100 years ahead, 500 years, 1,000 years, and finally a million years in the future, where the human historian records a time capsule of sorts a few hours before Sol, the sun that orbits the Earth, explodes in a nova. So, Babylon 5 is saved by TNT, and not only gets a fifth season, but four movies to fill in the gaps between seasons and detail some of the major conflicts. A new spinoff, Crusade, enters production, destined to start after Babylon 5's final season is over. It all seemed like a success story. Well, let's talk about Season 5 first. You can tell just from Season 5's intro that Season 4 burned through most of the relevant detail without a lot to go on. The intro is just a recap of previous seasons. It felt rushed, like JMS couldn't figure out a good theme to go on, or was just juggling too many balls. JMS had plans for Claudia Christian in season 5, but long story short, she ran afoul of asking for contractual agreements too late in the process. Season 4 was the true climax, and to be fair, nobody really knew there was going to be a season 5, so we're still lucky that we got what we got. Season 5 had its moments. We had conflicts between telepaths, Garibaldi spiraling into alcoholism, and the demise of the Centauri Empire. It felt smaller than what we saw previously, but there was some good character development along the way. People moving on, both with good and bad outcomes, the season winding down, and the final send-off with Sleeping in Light. That series finale felt just as bittersweet for me as Sheridan knowing that his own death was imminent. First he says goodbye to his friends, then goodbye to the love of his life, then finally visits Babylon 5 one more time. He talks with Zack, holding the fort for a to-be-decommissioned Babylon 5. But sensing his final moments, he returns to the scene of the final battle between the first ones, where he disappears with him. And finally the station blows up, which I thought was a bit showy, but I guess the CGI folks wanted to do something during that episode. Overall, it was a great end to a great series. Which is more than I can say about Crusade. Okay, we have to talk about Crusade and TNT now, because the sheer injustice of what transpired has to be retold. I know some of you browncoats are still sore about Firefly 20 years later, but what Fox did to Firefly was merely stupid. Fox thought the ratings weren't high enough and simply canceled a good show. However, what TNT did to Crusade was downright malicious. Crusade was a new spin-off series JMS had with its own 5-year plan. It continued in the Babylon 5 universe, where Earth is quarantined for the rest of the galaxy, infected with an advanced plague created by the Drock. TNT even produced a made-for-TV movie detailing the battle right before the events of Crusade. The show had a host of good actors, Gary Cole, Daniel Day-Kim, Peter Woodward, who basically steals the show as a technomage, Carrie Dobro. But this series was doomed to fail, canceled only after 13 episodes. It was discovered much later by JMS himself that, while the fifth season of Babylon 5 was airing, TNT noticed that their Babylon 5 viewers were only sticking around for Babylon 5 content, and most of their other viewers were bailing when Babylon 5 came on, only to return later. Now, most of you watching may think, huh, why is this a problem? Don't people just channel surf to the show they want to watch and then move on to the next show on a different channel? Isn't that why we demanded streaming in the first place? So that we can just watch a series and move on to the next one? Sure, you might think that, but you, my friends, are not TV executives. The second piece of information TNT got was a survey that they did of their viewership, and they found that, overall, their viewers didn't like science fiction. Well, when most of the network isn't science fiction, I'm sure you'll find that a majority of the viewers aren't fans of science fiction. And so what? I'm sure UPN in its first year of its network didn't have a lot of non-science fiction fans either. A vast majority were there to see Star Trek Voyager, not the rest of the lackluster shows that were all unceremoniously canceled the next year. So what does TNT do with this information? Do they suck it up and enjoy the dedicated viewership watching this one show and see where it lands? Well, we know that doesn't happen. So why not just cancel the show outright with the information they received? Because they still have a contract to uphold. Instead, they fuck with the production. After 5 episodes were shot, they paused production and started sending notes for suggested changes to the story, which JMS described as reprehensible and morally outrageous. TNT wanted to fill the show to the brim with sex and violence, but all of this was a ruse to claim that they wanted to cancel the series over creative differences. Episodes were shuffled around, including pushing the unaltered first 5 episodes to the end. Time slots were changed. TNT didn't even bother to advertise the show. JMS could tell what was coming, and eventually decided to completely ignore their line changes, even with threats of cancellation. And in January of 1999, Crusade was already officially canceled with just a half a season, 5 months before it even aired. They obviously didn't care about the ratings. Fans immediately petitioned TNT to reverse their decision, but none of them knew the extent of how TNT purposely sabotaged the show. Despite all of this, the show actually did fairly well in ratings when the show was finally aired in June of 1999. Was this the end? No, because the Sci-Fi Channel was still interested in taking it on, just a few months after the cancellation announcement. But in a final act of spite, TNT intentionally charged a crazy high price for the property. And surprise, surprise, the Sci-Fi Channel couldn't find room in their budget. And that last nail in the coffin doomed the fledgling series for good. Straczynski himself moved on to several other projects post-Crusade. He was showrunner for the Showtime series Jeremiah, wrote the screenplay for Changeling, was a key writer for Thor, and was the lead writer for The Amazing Spider-Man for 6 years, writing several pivotal stories for Spider-Man. He worked for both Marvel and DC Comics and various other series as well. He owns his own comic book imprint called Joe's Comics, which has produced several series over the years. More recently, he wrote Netflix's Sense8 series, along with the Wachowskis, and wrote a comic series this year called Moths. His work has, unfortunately, had a history of cancellations and studio interference, but he isn't afraid of walking away from a project if it isn't working out, and presses on with the stories that he feels that must be told. The Babylon 5 universe did have other properties produced. Del Rey and Dell Publishing both produced a host of novels, both during and after the TV series was still running. Most of these novels are based on JMS's notes and considered canon. They resolve a lot of the plot lines left over from the Babylon 5 TV series. Several comics were made, most of which were written by JMS himself. In 2007, Warner Brothers produced a direct-to-TV two-part series called The Lost Tales. It was just two 36-minute episodes, produced on a low budget. Though it received sales well beyond what they anticipated, the reviews were lukewarm, mainly due to the restrictive budget. Warner Brothers was interested in another set of episodes, but Straczynski did not agree of setting a budget similar to the first one. Quoting JMS, "If anything else should be continued from that story, it should be something that adds to the legacy of Babylon 5, rather than subtracts from it." So, JMS drew his line in the sand to only continue stories from the universe if it had the budget to accommodate it. And here we are in 2021. The years have passed, and too many actors from the series have sadly passed away to really tell anything else within the Babylon 5 universe. But its legacy lives on. JMS even recently announced plans for a new Babylon 5 series reboot for a whole new generation. I look forward to see how that turns out, but I'm always going to have a soft spot for the original Babylon 5 series. JMS dared to challenge the norms of standalone episodic television series and ushered a new era of gripping continuous stories, where decisions have long-term consequences and audiences are treated with the intelligence to follow along on the journey. What people did with that idea varied with wildly different degrees of success. JMS mostly had his plans from the very beginning. From the first episode, he knew, for example, how the Shadow War would end up. Farscape, a series with its own ups and downs, cancellations, and revivals, did eventually tell its final act that its creators had been planning from the beginning. While the Peacekeeper Wars was a messy full season of storylines in a four-episode bag, it did manage to show arguably the most epic 15 minutes payoff in any sci-fi series.
God! 4 years on and you're finally getting that.
In the other direction, shows like Battlestar Galactica started out strong with stellar acting, music, and set pieces, but it suffered from plot lines that are developed with almost no long-term planning, ending in a rather tepid and disjointed series finale. Or Lost, which stretched out for too many seasons with a myriad of narrative dead ends. Or series that completely screwed up their endings, like Dexter, How I Met Your Mother, or the grandest series of them all, Game of Thrones. These series may have won their ratings, but they lost their legacy. There are various reasons for these failures. Showrunners that are too afraid of cancellation risks season to season. Purposely writing episodes in a short-term manner and expecting the writing crew to paint themselves out of corners. Focusing too hard on seasonal plots and not providing enough threads to tie the series together. Or you could run out of source material and decide to rush out an ending in time to bounce for a Netflix contract. Even the critically acclaimed series Mr. Robot had to shorten one of their seasons to accommodate Rami Malek's growing success and shrinking availability, compressing the last season in a manner similar to Babylon 5's fourth season. It was still a fantastic ending to the series, though. So it's hard to tell exactly how a series should plan for its story and endings. Should the writing team just fly by the seat of their pants and figure out the longer-term details later? We've already outlined the risks of not sticking the landing and tarnishing a series' legacy. Should it plan for a season, since that's the time span they're guaranteed from the studio? Some series like Westworld work that way, but it can lead to a disjointed series arc that doesn't have a clear direction forward. Should it have a plan from the very beginning and risk having those plans jeopardized from actor changes and cancellation risks? There's always risks in any project, really. Why The Last Man, a series I've been waiting for 20 years, just got canceled after one boring season. Dune, a series that everybody's been waiting for a good adaptation for over 50 years, finally has the movie version it deserves. But the stories live on, waiting for somebody else to adapt them better. JMS dealt with all those risks during the filming of Babylon 5, and he rolled with the punches. The legacy lives on, because people will remember how the narratives resolve. Stick the landing, because people will talk about it for decades to come. Finally, I'll close with a message. In that season 4 finale, The Deconstruction of Falling Stars, during the last few seconds of the episode, is a dedication. Straczynski explained the dedication in a CompuServe post. There will always be short-term setbacks, but as long as we climb a few inches higher than where we were before we fell down, we keep moving towards the goal of becoming a better people and getting off the planet, taking our place among the stars. While it's vaguely possible that I may see a Mars colony sometime within my lifetime, I know that I will never live there. But that ain't the point. It isn't a victory if I do it and a failure if I don't. It's if we do it or not. Maybe we'll do it today, maybe we'll do it tomorrow. The point is to decide to do it, and then by God, do it. And yeah, that little closing card is going to remain on the show for its life, which will be long, long after its detractors, and admittedly myself, have gone to dust. On the one hand, it is a statement of hope to anyone else out there who has a dream, to follow it no matter who speaks against you, no matter the odds, no matter what they say to or about you, no matter the roadblocks they throw in your way. What matters is that you remain true to your vision. On the other hand, for the reviewers and the pundits and the critics and the net stalkers who have done nothing but rag on this show for 5 years straight, it is also a giant middle finger composed of red neon 50 stories tall that will burn forever in the night. In billiards, we call that a bank shot. Faith manages. Faith manages indeed, Mr. Straczynski, even 25 years later.